agenda and why it is important. As Dr. Kumari said, in my basic degree I did chemistry special, but later I switched to molecular biology. And whatever, even though if you all are physical students, your intentions are becoming to be a physician or whatever, it's okay. We will just see why we say that DNA, what is DNA and why it is important. And you all know that DNA, also called as deoxyribonucleic acid, and it is there in humans as well as in any other organism. And this contains the biological instructions that make each species unique. Even person-to-person variation difference is due to this difference in DNA. And this DNA is passed from adult organism to their offspring during reproduction. And there are two types of DNA. It is nuclear DNA, and also we get small amount of mitochondrial DNA. And this is a cell. You have the nucleus, and in the nucleus you will get your nuclear DNA. And you might heard about what are genes, and there are also we get mitochondrial DNA. And when we come to the molecule of DNA, it's made up of chemical building blocks, and we call it as nucleotide. And these building blocks are made up of three parts. You get a phosphate group, a sugar group, and also there are nitrogen bases. When we come to the double helix of DNA, you have seen these pictures earlier also. Between two nitrogen bases, you will get hydrogen bonds. And you can see that in some there are three hydrogen bonds, and in some there are two hydrogen bonds. Between adenine and thymine, you get two hydrogen bonds, while between guanine and cytosine, you get three hydrogen bonds. And also, you might heard about proteins. Each DNA sequence, which contains the instructions, that is, each DNA sequence will form a protein. And this gene, the size of the gene, it will be varied. It can be 1,000 base pairs, or even it can go up to 1 million base pairs in human. And you might heard about the genome, human genome, or a bacterial genome, plant genome. And this genome contains households. And you know that DNA, it cannot be seen from a naked eye. And also, a lot of information are gathered in these DNA molecules. Therefore, it has to be tightly packed. From generation to generation, and also due to the production of proteins. Therefore, those are the two important factors in DNA. As an example, DNA determines the structure of the cell. Whatever the cell they are, DNA will determine what it is and how it is happening. Just a basic background about DNA. In late 18th century, the German biochemist first observed about the DNA. But however, we all know that in 1953, this came into the world. Huh? James Watson, Francis Crick, Morris Wilkinson, and Rosalind Franklin. In 1953, they described about the double helix of DNA. And due to the importance of DNA, United States government, when they completed the Human Genome Project in 2003, they declared 23rd of April as the DNA Day. That is, they give more emphasis and the importance of this DNA. That's why they commemorate it. And this is a photograph of Anton Conning. He's a bioinformatician who is discussing about the human genome. When we move into applications, the research about DNA work. Now, the scientists, they know how to control the DNA. DNA has a charge. Therefore, they can, by changing the salt concentrations in a solution, that is, by depending on the charge of the DNA, then you can change the salt concentration, and thereby they can control the size of the packed DNA. And it is important in gene delivery as well as in medical treatment where you can use it for disease prevention. And as I told you, DNA is the blueprint for biological life. And One of its application is the genealogy, that is the study of ancestry. And your whatever from each generation, you can find out where you came, your family tree. Biomedical research, pharmaceuticals, whatever, which will use DNA in for the use of improvement of our production. And why you should, I mean, whoever interested should study biotechnology. By studying biotechnology, you can understand how biological processes occur and how you can use this prevent for say that in cancer or whatever, if certain diseases appear, how you can use these biotechnological processes to improve the quality of that plant and to minimize the disease. DNA technology, it has used for many improvements in food production, to improve the quality of rice. You can introduce genes into the rice plant and can improve, that is change and all, there might be differences in plant production. Then we have to adapt those, I mean, we have to make those plants adapt to the coming climatic changes. For that also, you can modify by using these biotechnological processes. Either it can be for plants, and you might heard about genetically modified food, and in food production involving fish, in cattle, production of more milk, all that can be manipulated using these biotechnological processes.
Thank you.
there's a new field called structural DNA nanotechnology. And using nanostructures, they have used this DNA to transfer into a lot of cells. That is, whether this using the DNA nanotechnology inside a cell, say that if you have cancer in your body in a particular part, then using this, you can send the drug only to that particular cell. Because now these days, mostly when you treat cancer, you are giving the drugs either orally or through injections. Right? And that means the whole, whatever the drug medication you are giving, it will go entirely to your body. And that's why you see in patients, when they are given these drugs, they lose their hair. And it's a common sign. That's a side effect of that drug. But if you can find and give the drug to the particular target, that means you're minimizing the side effect of a drug. And using this nanotechnology, now the scientists have improved this drug delivery inside human beings. And here also is the times. What they have done is there are probes. They have put probes, DNA probes, into these chips. And you can see, I mean, what they interpret is whether the drug will go and bind it into it. DNA nanoarrays. And the left side, you can see the atomic force microscopic image of DNA nanoarrays. And whatever the probe in the nanoarray, and when if a RNA is born and binding to it, then you can see it in biting color. Whatever the hybridized places can be visually observed with this. And now people are using this nanotechnology for the application in plants. Earlier, I mean, they were able to either deliver protein or DNA separately into plants. But now, both DNA as well as proteins, simultaneously, they can send given into the plant. Using a technique called, I mean, what they can do is, both protein and DNA can be sent to the plant in one attempt. And how they can see whether that either protein or whether DNA has got into the plant by the fluorescence of either green color or the red color. If they see both red and green color, that means both have been got into the plant. But if only one color is being seen, that is either green or red, then only one particular, either it can be DNA or the protein. But if you see both, then you know that successfully both had been got into the plant. And this is DNA which are being used for the genetic diseases. First, they have tested these in these monkeys. That is, scientists have replaced bits of defective DNA in human egg with the equivalent DNA from a healthy egg. A technique that could prevent women from passing on several rare and potentially deadly disorders to their children. Because at the beginning I told identify the defects in the cell, then you can change that and you can remove the defective part with the donor's healthy one, then you can pass it to a new cell. First they did it with these monkeys, and these monkeys are now 3 years old and they are still living, and now they are testing into humans. And this is the technique, and here actually, as I told you earlier, it's microbial DNA which has been removed. In that DNA is which lies the defective part. And you know about e-books in the internet, you get e-books. Now they have found that even in DNA you can store your information. That is, 4 grams of DNA could store the digital data humankind creates in 1 year. Now, I will come to, as a molecular biologist, I work with DNA and I have 2 main projects. We are working with cyanobacteria, and also we work with tuberculosis. Cyanobacteria, blue-green algae, and there are a lot of things which we can learn with this cyanobacteria. And this cyanobacteria, we call it as, also previously called as blue-green algae. In lakes and all, you see, if you see a green scum on the water surface, you know that it's mostly due to the blue-green algae present in those waters. But certain these cyanobacteria, only some have the green color, and certain cyanobacteria you don't see them, and they are in water reservoirs. And why we are working on this? These cyanobacteria have a lot of secondary metabolites which are important in biotechnology. That is, you can get enzymes and other things. And also, these cyanobacteria, they produce toxins. And these toxins are harmful to humans. And there are 2 types of toxins in mainly studied toxins worldwide. That is microcystins and cytotoxin. And how molecular techniques can be used to find out these toxin producing microbacteria. That's what we work on. And secondly, the second project is tuberculosis. And tuberculosis, we get tuberculosis even in Sri Lanka. And also, when you identify, diagnose a tuberculosis person, if you are, then he or she will be treated for 6 months with the standard drug course. But now, it's a problem worldwide. There are a lot of drug-resistant strains are there. And this tuberculosis organism, it's a slow-growing organism. That is, it takes about 3 to 8 weeks to grow in a culture, if you grow it. And to identify this organism, this culture technique is necessary. But we use molecular techniques to identify this tuberculosis bacteria in patient samples. And I told you that we have standard drugs for tuberculosis. Mostly 2 drugs. It's INH and rifampin. And the resistant, there are resistant genes. patient will become very sick with TB, and sometimes it can be he or she might get the she will die due to this bacteria. But the thing is, if you give proper drugs and if you identify which drug can be given to the patient, you can prevent it. I widely used in my lab for both TB as well as for for the cyanobacterial detection. And in this technique, PCR, polymerase chain reaction, we can amplify the amount of DNA, therefore we can see it visually, because you know that DNA is very small amount in a cell. You can't see it through your naked eye. And therefore, to increase the amount of DNA, thereby to visualize it, we use this technique. And I told you earlier that DNA is a double-stranded helix. And by applying temperature around 94, you can break the double-stranded DNA. Then you get two separate strands, and then by addition of chemicals, you can form new DNA strands. For this technique, there are three specific temperatures which we use, and about after an hour or two, you can get 2^n times of DNA compared to the your initial product, initial chemicals which you used. We can see this DNA. We use the technique called gel electrophoresis. As I told you earlier, DNA is a charged molecule, and it's when you form this gelatinous material and you apply the DNA into those wells and you give a power supply, then your DNA will migrate from cathode to anode, and you are using the gel documentation system, you can observe it, because without this amplification you won't be able to see DNA, and the migration of DNA